It's Wednesday night live from Box O Studio, the shadow of Hamilton Mountain, barbershop podcast, bringing you lively banter and live music, the very best of original music and musicians every week, right to your living room, your bedroom, your phone, your car, wherever you need to get it. What we do here is we bring you original independent music, stuff that you maybe not be able to find easily unless you have discovered it, and then you can't help but find it and to share it. We know we are deeply infected here at Barbershop Podcast with the bug, and we get great joy every week bringing you someone who is full of talent, ambition, and has a story to tell. And two guys who don't really have a story to tell are Ryan Cannon and Gary Greenland, especially Gary Greenland, because we refused to get him a mic. Apparently you went upstairs and you asked management about it, and they said absolutely not. So
we tried.
But we're going to, again, we will launch that Kickstarter campaign to buy Gary's gold-plated microphone. Like, Mike, 2 years this month.
Wow.
That's impressive.
I guess he's overdue.
He's overdue for a microphone. But Ryan Cannon, it's good to see you. Have
it's
you
good
back.
Good to see you, yes. Yeah, thanks for having me.
It's great.
Of all the options of people you have to do this, thanks
you get
for
way late.
Picking me.
We bring up a crew and they drag you off the couch and throw you in the back of the van, bring you here every week kicking and screaming. You love it. I know you do.
I do. I'm still doing it.
Not a huge technical show tonight. Not tons of drum risers, electric guitars, and lights and whatnot. What we got is some killer singer-songwriting. Someone I know you're going to be excited to check out tonight on Barbershop Podcast. The vehicle is known as Color Film. The artist is Matthew de Zote, and he's our guest tonight on Barbershop Podcast, episode number 181. How you doing, Matt?
Good. Yourself?
I'm doing really well. You were saying your wife is a farmer. You live
she is.
Yeah. Does that bring you closer to the earth, as it were?
Yeah, I spend a lot of time on my knees, so I guess so.
It would work that way, right?
Yeah. It's a good way to keep yourself humble and grounded.
Yep.
So.
And they say that when you grow things, it's closest to being God that you'll be able to get away with as humans. As
I guess he has shit under his fingernails, too.
As mere mortals, he's got to mind the garden, as we do. Songwriting, musicianship, it comes in a lot of different forms. We've had a lot of different types of musicians and songwriters in here, and we usually start when we talk to them asking about their association with music, like their earliest memories or when they started noticing music. Do you have a specific time in your life when music kind of entered the story?
It was probably my mom. My mom always played guitar, so often at night when we were going to bed, she would sing songs to us with the guitar. Or at Christmas time, she'd always bring a guitar with to big family get-togethers. We'd sing Christmas carols, and then if we were camping, we'd sing around the campfire. Stuff like that, I guess, was probably my earliest memory of music.
So there was no fear of you going out into the great unknown. You know that this is something that can be done, and it brings joy.
Yeah, usually it brings joy. People like to sing along.
Yeah.
So.
Did you have an aptitude for it right away?
Maybe. They put me in piano when I was 5 or so, and I seemed to gaff onto it easily enough. Whether or not I was really any good, I don't know. And I was on and off again with piano for a while, and then picked up guitar when I was 11 or 12. And yeah, I really enjoyed it, and I had a lot of spare time back then. So when you find something that you like and you have spare time, then generally you spend a lot of time doing it.
Now, like playing from that early age, did it find it kind of put you ahead of the curve a bit musically with the other kids who were 11 and 12 at that age, or did you play what was popular music at the time?
I don't know.
Or were you writing already at that time?
No, I didn't start writing until I was maybe 15 or so. But I was playing, a lot of Neil Young, Bob Dylan, Leonard Cohen songs, so stuff that my parents listened to.
At 11 and 12.
Yeah. I had a good friend whose father was really into music, and that was kind of the stuff that I was learning from him. And he this friend played guitar and his father did as well. So, yeah. So they were kind of, I guess they pointed me in the direction of what songs that I would learn.
Right.
And just happened to be down those alleys.
You remember your first live performance? Let's call it a proper gig, not playing in front of relatives, but kind of like a stage and an audience.
It might have been down at the London Bridge in Hamilton. I don't think it's there anymore, so I don't think I'd get them in trouble by saying that. I bought an awful lot of underage beer there.
Yeah, quite a few people did.
I think so. And, yeah, I play there sometimes with my brother. So when I was maybe 16 or 17 or so.
And who were the acts around town at the time? That because you were too young to go and really check out much live music yourself.
Yeah,
right?
And to be honest, the stuff that I would my earliest memories of going to see shows in Hamilton were down at the old La Luna or Casbah,
yeah.
And I would see Thrush Hermit, Joel Plaskett's old band,
yeah.
Super Friends, Flashing Lights, Local Rabbits, stuff like that. So some stuff that was on Sonic Onion, but then yeah, a lot of East Coast stuff as well.
And does that kind of musicality attract you? A certain, you know, I don't want to use a reuse term like a Celtic or Acadian, but an East Coast sensibility. I mean, I find when I pick up a mandolin, it seems to come out that way automatically,
sure.
Right? It's got a jig quality to it.
Yeah, I found those bands, it was more, I don't know, it's like, I guess what would now be called indie rock, but
right.
There was like their songwriting sensibility and the aesthetic they were coming from was somewhat aligned with the stuff that I was listening to, which by then was a lot of like early Who stuff and the Birds and the Beatles,
yeah.
And like that mid to late 60s, where there's a roughness to it, but there's also a cleanliness to it,
yeah.
Somehow, and that really appealed to me, and I think that was fairly formative.
Yeah, I mean, and when you start digging into someone like Pete Townsend and you listen to those arrangements and you listen to those words, you understand how important, and quite often with a relative economy of cordage, you know, you really don't have to go too far and understand within that the musicianship that can build. It's really,
yeah.
You know, because he said, he's quoted like Eddie Vedder and so many contemporaries say, oh, you know, Pete Townsend was the first person who showed me you don't have to go and get a degree to be a writer, right?
Right.
You can write a song with three chords, like guys like him and Ray Davies. And,
yeah.
And do a bang up job, right? It
yeah.
Doesn't have to be necessarily pedestrian. All right, you've got a brand new baby,
brand
as I
new
mentioned.
Baby.
So tell me about color film and how you are color film and how you are not color film. And tell me about what this means, and then we'll talk about the release in April.
Sure. Well, I'm not color film in that my birth certificate doesn't say color film, but I guess, yeah, it's the name that I perform under now. I played for 10 years or so under my own name, and the idea of color film kind of started sticking in my mind in terms of how I approach music and songwriting, trying to, I guess, write songs and record songs that have a bit of a visual element to them, something that people can see when they're listening, maybe close their eyes and see there. I guess trying to write or make songs that can act almost like home movies for people. Maybe some characters or a plot or a situation or emotions or something that I guess has some detail to it, something that's maybe a little bit familiar and rings a bell, but I guess is still open to interpretation and imagination. And that's kind of, I realized over the last little while, that's what I'm trying to do with music.
Yeah.
And having a name like that hopefully is a little less awkward than having to spell D E Z O E T E so many times. So yeah, sometimes I play solo, sometimes with the full band, sometimes
yeah.
A small ensemble.
It affords you that kind of creative leeway, right?
Yeah, hopefully.
Hopefully, and as you said, the kind of art, because music is art and it's interpretive, and having that kind of texture is important as well. We're gonna play a track, and I guess it's a live cut called Fall.
First, I'm gonna play The Money's on the Dresser.
Are you?
If that's okay.
You can absolutely play The Money's on the Dresser.
That's how I like to wake up.
You'll wake with it. So is there anything we often ask and say, is there something that you want to share? Is it something you'd rather not share? Yeah.
Oh, it's, I don't know. I think every song has a, songs have varying degrees of truthfulness to them. I guess there's always a kernel of truth, I think, to every song, whether or not it's something that's from real life or something that just rings true, even if it's imagined. So I guess the song, the title came first, and then I kind of wrote it around it.
Nice. All right. We're going to hear it right here, right now. Live, barbershoppodcast.com.
I woke up with the sun, went out to get something done. The only time we get along is when one of us is asleep or gone. Starlings in the trees, the best things in this life. Love ain't what you give to me, I better pay before I leave. The money's on the dresser. The money's on the dresser.
Film, barbershoppodcast.com. When I read about your reviews about you, seems like the, especially now that you've told me that you're playing Cohen when you were 12 years old, it's very important that there's an integrity that kind of goes with the music. Do you have guilty pleasures when it comes to music, or phases where you just want to not think so much and dance, or do you see it as a calling where you constantly have to work on?
I guess in terms of music that I make, I think of it as, I guess, kind of a calling.
Yeah.
In terms of music that I listen to, yeah, I guess my guilty pleasures would be like early Kinks. yeah. early Beatles. They're not saying a whole lot. I guess by like 1966 or even 65 with the Kinks, they're starting to say something, and it sounds like maybe they're not all the time.
Yeah.
There's a lot of silliness there, but there's always a deeper undercurrent of it's like, that's what I notice, especially with the Kinks. It's like, wow, if you can dance to it and you can just shake your head around to it. But if you listen, it's like, oh, there's a whole world of characters here. Great. And it's like these tiny little details of life that are like, hey, I can relate to that.
Yeah. And definitely the way they paint a picture. And people don't understand. It's like someone who's making the first film and they realize how much they have to edit out to make it happen. Same with songwriting. You know, it's like you've got this idea, and to have that picture appear in your head and have the mood or have your own story become a universal theme, that's a bit of a trick. Have you always been a wordsmith? Were you good in the English and the writing and those aspects?
Yeah, I have a history degree and I have a minor in English, so... And I've always, been into reading and writing. Right. School always came very easily to me. Yeah. Thinking about things and writing about things has always been something that I've done. And songwriting, I guess, is the avenue of doing that seems to come most naturally, or that I get the most pleasure out of.
Yeah. Do you do any other art forms?
I do some visual arts. I used to do it a lot more. Now... don't really have the time. I still draw with the kids. We have two little girls. So I draw pictures for them and have them color them and things like that.
Yeah.
The occasional birthday card.
Well, it's nice that you grew up in a family where music and the arts was understood, that this wasn't a guilty pleasure, or this wasn't a, you know, a time waster, that was something that fed the mind.
Yeah. And I think my parents always approached music the same way. Like, I don't know any popular music from the 80s or early 90s just because it was not on ever
well,
in
your
my
dinner
house.
Plate.
No, it was a complete lack of pop culture in my childhood. It was, yeah, like the music that I mentioned, but then choral music or orchestral music or things like that.
And yet you've arrived heroically well adjusted somehow.
Half of that's true, even the heroic part. Yeah.
All right. Heroic efforts. We talk about making CDs. Yeah, and we call them that. You know, albums or CDs. It's nice having a physical presence. It's nice having something that long after we're gone, this will exist. Was there something specific you wanted to say at this point in time when you made this, or is this a collection of snippets from your life and what you were going through?
A bit of both, I guess. I wanted songs that tied into that idea of color film. And, songs that have a visual aspect or a little narrative or those little details. Right. So there are a lot of songs that I had written that I didn't think quite fit the bill. And it was just kind of finding those songs that work together aesthetically, but then also fit that notion and then seem to go together a little bit.
Well, it's produced by our great friend Les Cooper, and we're going to play a track off it. This is just a month old. People can get a hold of it. There's going to be a link to it on the website, your own website, I imagine. We're going to listen to a song called Fall. Anything you want to tell us about this one?
I guess it's my attempt at a love song. I've been married a while, so you have to try to fall in love over and over.
Love it. All right. Fall, barbershoppodcast.com.
I've been painting you black. I'm a 7-year itch that you can't scratch. Baby, I take it back. I've been building a wall. I'm going.
From Color Film, great project with Matthew de Zote. You've got a great kind of sensibility for what a pop song is, and not to go too deep, but there can be quite a chasm between a song of great import and one that resonates. What do you think the tricks are?
I don't know. I guess a lot of it is practice, because I've written a couple hundred songs that don't deserve to see their light of day. Yeah. Or, you know, maybe they're okay. But
bits and pieces?
Yeah, bits and pieces, or just fully realized. Most, they're all fully realized or fully written songs. It's just, you know, maybe they get to like 75%, 80% or 90% of, yeah, spanning that gulf or hitting that nail on the head. Yeah. So a lot of it is practice. And then a lot of it is finding... I guess just the right inspiration and being willing to put in the time to see it through. Like there's, yeah, so many songs that I've seen through that aren't good enough. And then it's just,
Are you a good self-critic though? Like, because sometimes people are, again, depending on the ebb and flow of our emotions, like incredibly hard on ourselves. And then other times maybe
I'm
much
pretty,
less so.
I think I'm pretty hard on myself.
But fair?
I think when I... Generally, my intuition, if I'm finishing up a song, is pretty good in terms of, yeah, the song has something to it, or I'm going to forget about
so
the song.
There's no chance about that hidden gem in there somewhere.
No, that's true.
Because
that song, there can be hidden gems. Like that song, Fall, yeah, actually was a song that I had written and liked, but then I wasn't playing it live, yeah, and I'd kind of forgotten about it. And then when I started working on this project with Les Cooper, the producer, I did play this one for him just in case, because you never know, and we tweaked it just a little bit and that changed it a fair bit. And another thing is finding sometimes the right person to work with.
Yeah,
can be,
let's talk about that. You know, when you're working as some, especially someone like yourself who takes the lead in so many things out of necessity, you know, first of all money, and second of all, you know, not time, resources, and also, you know, you've got that penchant. And if you don't do it, no one else is going to. But when it comes time to go into a studio and have a producer, talk about that relationship and how important that is to have someone that who you respect that you can listen to.
For me, at least, it's really important. I don't have a lot of experience recording. I've done a bunch of albums, but I've don't have much experience sculpting a sound, or I don't work in studios. So to me, it's kind of a foreign land. I know what I do. So especially working with Les, or actually my first two records I recorded with Dave King in Caister Center, just outside of Hamilton. And that was the first time I found someone that I could really bounce songs off of and have them be really critical at times and really supportive and complimentary at times, and pull out what was really good in what I was doing and find a way to throw out what wasn't so good in what I was doing to kind of strengthen what I was doing. And then, yeah, when I started working with Les, it was the same thing in terms of finding someone that you trust enough and respect enough to take their ideas. Then also just keeping in mind, if there's a new idea, you should always just try it, because you can't break a song. It's not like if you're carving a piece of wood, if you take too many scrapes off, it's gone. With the song, it's like, oh, let's try it in 3/4 time and in this key. It's like, no, that's terrible. Let's go back to, it's always there.
Yeah, what a great analogy right there.
Yeah, so with Les, it was like finding the good parts and tossing out the bad parts, but then also saying like, this is pretty good, but if let's try this and maybe it will be better. And sometimes it's slow the song down, speed it up, change the key, change the feel a little bit.
And you being open to doing that and having that, again, communication, right?
Yeah, and I learned, I think pretty early on, like with all the recording situations I've been in, if you find the right people, the best thing you can do is take your hands off the wheel.
Yeah.
And it gives a little bit of guidance, but if you've got the right people and they're sympathetic and they're hearing things kind of in the same vein, then they're only going to make it better. And like this recording and the last record that I did with the same group of players, it was totally like that. So I would play a demo and we would all kind of work on the arrangement together as we were tracking the beds.
Yeah.
And just everybody was on the same page.
Yeah.
So there was, didn't take much effort, there were no teeth pulling. It was just everybody kind of, without knowing what the goal was, everyone was heading for the same goal.
Absolutely. Words to live by. Listen, he knows what he speaks. All right, you're going to do another live one for us.
Sure.
Now, what's this one called?
It's called Tomorrow.
Tomorrow? Anything you want to share?
Sure. I spend a lot of time thinking and talking and singing about the past, it seems. In terms like the name Color Film comes from old Super 8s from my grandparents that we'll talk about in a bit. And a lot of songs think about the past, but the song is about the future. And I guess when you reach a certain age and start to have these different things happen in your life, you think about the future a little bit. So
very true. A message and some music right here, right now, live, barbershoppodcast.com.
At this picture of us taken half a year ago, smiling at something that the camera doesn't show, and every day since then something's grown. Tomorrow I can't wait for tomorrow. I love these moments where we're frozen in the time before. We stepped across the threshold of that open door, holding in our breath, see what grows tomorrow. Tomorrow I can't wait for tomorrow. What will the next few pictures be? Will we keep smiling happily? Oh, I guess we'll have to wait. What will your favorite color be? Will you grow up to look like me? Oh, I guess we'll have to wait for tomorrow. Thank you.
barbershoppodcast.com. God, we love music and we love musicians and we love the community. We want to talk about our great sponsor over at hamiltonartist.ca. They have there's a whole new line of barbershop podcast merch that you're going to be able to check out at hamiltonartist.ca. you know, mugs, mouse pads, hoodies, t-shirts, all the good stuff, anything you want. They print anything on anything. That's their logo, because they stand behind that, from the smallest thing to, like, from a golf tee to your signage in front of your building, wrapping your car, laser printing, etching, custom stage wear. They could probably make you a nudie suit if you wanted one, you know, go up there like Graham Parsons. They are about to move to new locations because they're busting at the seams right there. Presently, they're at 1141 Main Street East at Balmoral. I was bugging them to tell me. They said, no, we're not going to jinx it and tell the new location until we sign the deed, and apparently went down today. So Hamilton artists are going to be telling you next week what the new location is. But in the meantime, you can get them online right now at hamiltonartist.ca. Let them be your voice when you have a company icon, band, logo, name, or an idea you want promoted. Check out their online promotions and sales. Become a member. See what they got on your gallery. If you're a band, or you're a sports team, or you're a school, a charity, anyone, you got to check them out. hamiltonartist.ca. All right, we've got some color film on the show tonight. That is the musical entity that we have in here. We're not even going to try to describe it. I like how you, in your bio, it's kind of tough to paint a picture sometimes when people say, what do you do? What's your music sound like? And you want to be, give them a couple tags, so give them an idea if it's something they might want to check out, and yet leave room for rampant individualism. Like, how have you managed to do it? What do you tell people when they ask you what you sound like?
I'm always tempted to go back to the Old Testament and just say, I am that I am. But I'm not too sure if that...
Is that where it is what it is came from?
It could be. It could be where Popeye got it from, too. I am what I am. But if people just want one sentence, I just tell them to imagine Nick Drake cheering up a little bit, just a little, and meeting Beck.
Yeah. And so. And those are both, artists who aren't particularly easy to quantify. You know, within a genre, they sit comfortably, and yet what makes them so remarkable? Kind of a fearlessness, you know, and I think in a kind of, an oral, A-U-R-A-L, texturing, soundscaping, where that is as important as the lyrics, because if someone's going to get into what you have to say, you have to create the environment that's going to make them want to, right? So talk about musicianship. Are you in fear of music and quality of music and what's happening with the dumbing down of music, that there's too many, shortcuts, electronic music, things that, or do you think cream will rise to the top and what will be at the end of the day?
Yeah, I think the cream will always rise. I think there's still a lot of great players. I think in some ways the technology that's there makes it a little easier to not have to give that great performance from start to finish. Although, I mean, even from the late 50s already there was, you know, overdubbing or splicing and all that. But it does make it a little easier. You can fix some mistakes. But I think the bottom line is you still need to have a great performance in order to come across to people, to give people something to grab onto. And different people are always looking for different things out of music. Some people just want a four on the floor beat in the background that feels good, and other people really want to sink their teeth into something, and one isn't better than the other. They're just different.
Well put. So. And that's why there's so many different genres, and people should be fearless, you know, because you're allowed to like different things at different times. Yeah. Not even in your life, but time of day.
Yeah.
You know, it's like, it's not all the same. And respect your music. Buy some decent stuff, right? Like, stop listening to music through these speakers here, right? That's not helping anyone. You need to at least get a good set of headphones, hopefully a set of speakers, an amplifier with some power. Close your eyes, turn the screen off, and let music kind of take you away. Because it does. It does that. All right, we're going to play another track off of your Wickedly Good CD. Going to give me a chance to get a little more wine.
Wine is good.
Wine is good. We'll have to thank Peller Estates, my sister Michelle Brisbois. Not that she comped this one, but she works there. She's an estate manager, and they make good wine. I tell you, boy, I'd like a sponsorship like that, I tell
you. Yeah.
Okay, we're going to do a video. Color film. What's the connection?
Oh, this song is actually from not the new record, but the record before, and it was the title track. So because I'm a marketing genius, what I did was I released a full-length record called Color Film under my name, Matthew de Zote, and now I'm following it up with an EP called Super 8 under the band name Color Film.
Brilliant.
Very brilliant.
You get about five different quadrants all wrapping around something.
But this song, I guess, is what kind of started that idea rolling.
Yeah.
I wrote this song for my grandparents. My parents were both born in the Netherlands and immigrated to Canada as kids in the 50s. And so my grandparents, I always have known them as these older Dutch people. And they're loving people that I've always loved spending time with, but they've always seemed a little bit different to me because they come from a different world. And I think I probably spent a fair bit of my life just assuming that they were background characters who waited around until I came on the scene and made things worthwhile.
Yeah.
And then a couple of years ago, I saw these old family movies, actual Super 8 footage from the early 60s.
They had a life.
Yeah, there's a big family reunion party. Some their brothers and sisters from the Netherlands came over. They had this big party, and I saw them like I'd never seen them before. So I realized right then that they had their own lives and that their lives were just as complex and as round and full as mine.
That's great.
So I wrote this song for them, and then the video is actually made up of the actual footage that inspired it.
Beautiful. Beautiful concept, beautiful stuff right here. Color Film on barbershoppodcast.com.
Family, I saw you on a color film from 1963, and I saw you and your sister's smile, swinging with your cigarettes and your songs. I saw you and your sister's smiling and laughing and singing along.
Color now, it's color now to me.
I thought your life was black and white, but it's color now. I thought your life was black and white, but it's color now. On a color film, and you looked just like me.
Yeah, that was the track Color Film from the album and the band of the same name. Getting it all together. Well, you know, one thing I never realized about the Dutch people. Like salt of the earth, like they're very, very, like they have that Teutonic kind of element of the Germans with organization and everything in the right place, and yet they have this wonderful freedom of individuality where they celebrate that, and they invented everything. You sit down with a Dutchman and you start talking about anything, and they'll say, "Well, you know."
The Dutch invented that. They also invented claiming everything. That's a Dutch concept.
It so is. Yeah. Love it. Thinking about early in-laws, of course, you know. And that's the people that you meet, you know, in this business. I feel sorry for, even if you're a traveling salesman, you're going to conferences and you're going to your sales meetings and you're going to your calls. It's that same microcosm spread over a geographical area. And yet the opposite's kind of true with music. You can be in a different place, but every single place has, it's like eating food regionally. It soaks up the flavor. It has that thing where, of course, it's food, but what spices and what context and what amounts and the preparation and even the act of sharing and serving is different. Was that like any kind of revelations for you as far as performing live, like both in this country and out of this country?
A little bit. I found, especially playing in Europe, people, not everywhere, but in the right environment, are very attentive and very appreciative, or at least they seem that way. It might not be their favorite thing, but there's a slightly different approach to interacting with live musical performance, especially if it's, say, like a solo singer songwriter. It's treated, it's a concert, but it's also got a little bit of like an arts performance aspect to it. I've noticed some places, say in Eastern Canada, it's like, it's not. What I do wouldn't occasion a kitchen party, but there's a different feeling somehow.
Yeah.
Of especially if a lot of people in the audience know each other and there's a bit more of a convivial feeling.
Yeah, but a reverence that goes with the secret handshake, that kind of the unspoken handshake.
That's it.
All right, we're gonna do another live tune because that's what we do so well here at Barbershop Podcast. What you got up next for us?
I think The Good Life. I think. Yep. I can play The Good Life.
What's not to like about The Good Life? I'm not even going to ask you what it's about. I'm just going to introduce it. The Good Life, what we should all aspire to every day. BarbershopPodcast.com.
I've got my hands in the sea. I'm washing dishes while the sun goes down, and from the shower you see about the night that drove a Dixie down. I'm gonna take you out tonight. You're giving me the good life. You're giving me the good life. You're getting dressed in a room. I hear the ticking tack of highest shoes. The sun's got nothing on you. And there's nothing I would rather do there's always nothing to hide. You are the greatest of everything. What a lie. I've got these dish pans. You let them hold you till it's closing time. You like that look. I'm gonna hold you till the morning shines. I'm gonna take you home tonight. You're giving me the good life. 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 You're giving me the good life.
The good life on barbershoppodcast.com. Speaking of the good life, you want the good life? You got to grind your taxes. And if you don't want to grind your taxes, someone else could grind them for you. We're going to give a little shout out to Taxes Done Right. You can reach them at 905-529-6435. Get yourself some fully prepared professional taxes. Get them done now. As, you know, even if you owe money, you want to get it in. If someone else has done your taxes for you, they just rubber stamp that shit for you. Especially when the person doing it has successfully completed all their preparation courses to keep abreast of all of the tax changes. There's a no-charge e-file for your taxes, and we're talking $25 a return, much, much less than you would pay at H&R Block, one of those shiesty places. Refunds over $500 or 5% fee, and Boxo Studio and Barbershop Podcast clients and guest preferred pricing. Can't go wrong with that. Anyway, go see them, get your taxes done, feel good, get that pressure off. Speaking of pressure off, music. Especially when you make it your calling, make it a business. There's the ups and downs, and there's a grind of combining your passion with a business plan. Is that something? Or like, are you naturally adept at that, or is this a constant struggle between the artist and the promoter?
I'm not very good at business or promotion. I'm very good at organization, which is helpful for booking tours. I book all my own shows. So, yeah, booking a tour across Canada or throughout Europe, that I don't particularly enjoy because it's a lot of time on the computer. Yeah. But that sort of organizational thing does come naturally to me, and that has been very helpful because you don't need that necessarily to make music, but you do, unless if you have someone doing it for you, you need it to facilitate the making of music in front of people. The business part and the promotional part is not my forte. That's finding ways to get people to listen to music or come out to shows has never been a strength of mine. I'm not sure if it ever will be. That's something I have realized and have kind of accepted. I just do my best. I try new things. I get advice, and I just work hard and do my best and accept what I get.
And I'll tell this to any artist, you know, at any stage. My experience is I can, you know, as someone who's got a pretty thick Rolodex and is as dedicated his life to music, people still don't listen to me, you know, necessarily unless you're, you know. But a personal referral is still the very best. And if you go out and there's five people in that room and you give a killer show regardless, and there's five people in that room and that person goes, I saw someone tonight that just blew my mind. You got to like that person's chance of going to the show are much, much better than any other way you could have done it yourself, because you put your effort in your performance.
Yeah.
The proof is in the pudding.
So it is.
You know, it is true. It's my pleasure to be sitting here with Matthew tonight. Color Film, a project and a CD and a band. It is a culmination. It is a bunch of stuff that's come together over a bunch of time, and it's kind of fallen out at this point, at this time. Is how different is this from what you've done previously?
This record is kind of a continuation of my last full length, because I was working with the same producer and same musicians. So my last two records are a fair bit different than my first two. This is, yeah, different than my last one. It's kind of just continuing down the same path or finding new things along that road. It's new songs. I like to think I'm getting better. I hope I'm always getting better. That's kind of the goal.
Yeah.
So.
Well, Pull Out Bed's what we're going to play on the next one, and it conjures up all kinds of things. Could be a good thing of the kids having fun on vacation at Auntie May's on the way somewhere, or it could be that the old lady's got you on the, in the doghouse. Could be something in between. Are you going to let us a little glimpse of what the song's about?
I guess it's kind of somewhere in between. It's just a song that came out of, I guess, some late night head scratching and some pondering.
Yeah.
It's, I guess for some of those bigger questions.
It's a story open to interpretation.
There you go.
It's a pull-out bed, and it's from Color Film, and it's on barbershoppodcast.com.
In the dark.
of the wood. We love the wood here at Barbershop Podcast. The cedar, got to thank Scotty Bacalar, providing a great environment to make music and record music. And that was a great tune called Pull Out Bed from Color Film and Bicolor Film. And you can get a hold of it anytime you want to, right? If they want it bad enough.
If you want it bad enough, just go on the internet and look for Super 8 by Color Film.
There you go. Matthew de Zote. You got any shows coming up in the near immediate kind of future? Anything you're working on?
I just played a Canadian Music Week in Toronto last night.
Right. It's just kicked off, didn't it?
I play in Peterborough on Friday night. And then next week I head out to...
The Garnet? Where are you playing?
The Garnet. Yeah,
look at that.
And then next week I head out to Quebec City, Fredericton, Halifax, and the little town on PEI.
It's cool to see this country that way.
So yeah, you meet a lot of interesting people.
Did you already have a network of people who put you up here and there and everywhere?
Yeah. I've slept on my share of floors and couches all over the place.
And offer yours for any other traveling musician.
That's it.
That's the way it works.
And then after that, I take a couple weeks off, and then I go to Vancouver and back for a three-week tour, playing every night along the way.
Great. So any idea of how many gigs you do in a year these days?
It really varies. A couple of years ago, I was doing 100, 120. The last couple of years, not as much. Since we had a second child, it's a little bit busier at home, a little harder to be away.
And when you've got a wife in the field, it's like, my goodness, it's like not like she's sitting behind a computer and can, you know, she's got to strap the child on her back. With the sun hat.
Papoose style.
Papoose style, get out there.
Yeah.
All right. Live music. And again, having the ability, I imagine, when you write with the style of music you have, you hear an orchestration right off the bat. And so many people write on an acoustic guitar because it does provide the percussive elements, the melodic elements, and you're really able to texture that instrument around a song and to kind of let it build. Just asking, is it any other instruments that you really like to play?
I like keyboards. I have a piano and an organ at home. Actually, I have also an old harmonium, like with the foot pedals.
Yeah.
So it's nice to kind of mess around on things like
You're a fearless noodler, are you?
Yeah, definitely fearless. Not necessarily good, but yeah, it's fun to noodle. I have a drum kit and a bass and a couple other things. So anything, anything that allows you to, I guess, find something new or feel that excitement, that's always the most enjoyable.
And I was getting in a roundabout way. It's difficult sometimes when you write in that style, when you're writing principally on an acoustic guitar, not to get stuck in a rut where you're writing around the vocabulary that's afforded you.
Yeah.
But you're able to play the guitar like it's something else other than a guitar. So it's well done. What are you going to do for us next?
I'll try a song called Again and Again.
I like the way that sounds. Again and again, that's what you're going to do with Barbershop Podcast.
Again and again.
You're going to like it, you're going to share it, you're going to follow it, and you're going to make it part of your life. Again and again, right here, right now, barbershoppodcast.com.
Magic's gone. The good old days are done, and the new age has begun. I see you've made it through. I see you with someone new. What am I supposed to do? Seeing's not much fun. I would give my right hand if I could touch you again. Again and again. doesn't help to know I brought this on myself, and now you're someone else is having all the fun, and I wanna have some fun. My palms are hot, my fingers crossed. I'm all tied up in knots now. My nerves are shot, this can't go on. But I just can't stop. Touch you again and again, again and again. Again and again. Again and
Barbershop Podcast with Color Film, another fantastic original piece of music out of the great city of Hamilton, Ontario. Being a native son, like when you hear about Hamilton, when you travel around, people actually know that this is a music town, don't they?
Yeah, it's changed a lot. When I first started touring 10 years ago.
You did this?
I got a, you know, there'd be every now and again, well, there'd be a lot of groans. There's some boos. Yeah. Every now and again, someone would say, "Oh, I'm sorry," and I would, even then I was thinking, "What are you sorry about? I've been to your city a whole bunch of times, and I like mine better." But yeah. Everyone likes their art. Well, maybe not everyone, but I've always liked Hamilton. It has a lot of hidden gems, or a lot of beautiful neighborhoods, a lot of green space that nobody ever sees. But I grew up in Chatham until I was 11. And my grandparents on the one side were in St. Catharines, so we'd always drive by going over the Skyway, and my parents told us we were moving to Hamilton. It's like, are we going to live in a steel mill? Or all I knew was, what you see.
What you saw from that snapshot.
And then
and that's a little thing about life right there, isn't it? Quite often we take a snapshot, pass a judgment.
Yeah, but now it's when I tell people I'm from Hamilton, it's like, oh, I've heard really good things about Hamilton. Oh, it's really up and coming. Oh, very, really good, cool art scene there. So it's, I think it's great. There's a lot of energy.
Yeah, so do I. So do I. You know, it's like we don't need an imperialistic attitude about coming in here and saving and rescuing. And, you know, there's something about this town. And it's about, you know, the hardscrabble nature of it. And that someone's kind of always got, if they've made it, they certainly come by it, honestly, in this town. Mm-hmm. No one hands you anything. It is a tough town, you know, and you'll get your respect, but you're going to earn it. And if you are the casual music observer, you are the benefactor of that, because it's kind of like a, you know, kung fu school where only the strong survive. And there's no special privileges and patting on the back that goes on. You do it through a series of painful personal experiences. Growing up, getting tough, and there's a beauty to that. And we've got it in spades here in Hamilton, Ontario. All right, we've got another live tune. And do you like recording live? You like getting the energy? Do you record quite often stuff that's live and check it out and see if it's kind of comes up to what you thought it was at the time?
Yeah, I sometimes there's shuttering that goes on, but
because people don't understand, it's like the difference between a live recording and a studio recording is the difference between your prom photo being all photoshopped and waking up and having your brother
get
a picture of you, right?
Yeah. It's always it's always good to listen to. It's like, oh, that's what it sounds like. And sometimes it's helpful just to know how it's coming across and be like, oh, maybe I should do a little bit more of this and a little bit less of that, or oh, maybe I need to back off the mic there, or
yeah,
things like that.
Just like life, it's a learning experience, and just when you get it perfect and you're beautiful,
the learning experience,
it's time to go.
Yeah.
All right, we're gonna hear again and again.
I just played again.
Is it again, again?
Unless if you want to hear it again.
No, the changes.
Again. The changes, yeah. I thought it might be kind of cool to play it from...
What's that, Ryan? Was there someone piping up in there? No.
I heard footprints.
Is there footprints?
Yeah.
I don't even have footprints written down here.
No. I was going to say, I was thinking it would be cool to play the changes from the recording.
All right.
It's a song about old friends, so why not have some friends play with me?
I like that idea. All right, here it is, The Changes. From Color Film, by Color Film, on barbershoppodcast.com.
Now you're on my mind, driving past the place we used to live. And after all this time, those skeletons have something left to give.
Thank you. those were some beautiful, beautiful vocals on that. Who's singing on that?
A friend of mine named Julie Fader, also from Hamilton.
Oh, gotta love it. Great job, Julie. And great job by you. Great job, Les Cooper. That is a great album. I recommend that you check it out. Thank you so much for coming by.
My pleasure.
And sharing it with us. Another great week of music at barbershoppodcast.com. Bill Majoris, I was hoping I'd get him in next week. He is crazy busy. Probably isn't going to make it. I'm going to do a scramble show, come up with someone, a mystery guest next week. I don't even know who it is, but some of those have been some of the great ones. Because when we get Billy in here, I wanted to be like stoked. Man, I love good music. And you love good music. So if you love good music, subscribe. You know, all it means is every week you get it popped up in your feed there. There's a new episode. And we do it every week. Week in, week out. 181 in a row. Our pleasure. Thank you for joining us, Matthew.
Thank you.
Gary, Ryan, cracking job as usual. And for all of our audience members, both live on Twitch TV and in future. All right. Barbershoppodcast.com. See you next week. Kind of sheep.